Welcome to my birding channel. I'm James, and today I'm taking a short stroll through this park and hoping to see, of course, as many birds as I can find here. Come along with me and together let's see how many birds we can count. Come. Oh, by the way, do you know how many unique species of birds there are in Singapore? The usual number that's touted about today is just over 400 species. But this number varies depending on who you speak to. The National Parks Board, or NParks, has a list of 407 birds. The Singapore Bird Project, an independent special interest group, has 419 birds on their 2021 list. The Nature Society of Singapore had 414 birds in 2020, but reduced this to 407 in their latest 2021 list, recently published. The eBirds app has 461 unique sightings, while the Natural History Museum will also give you a different number depending on the category you are seeking. So, why are there slightly different numbers? Wouldn't you expect it would be the same number? And who exactly is the official authority to determine the number of bird species in a locality like Singapore? Would it be some government ministry, perhaps AVA or NParks? Actually, the de facto official count comes from an NGO, the Nature Society of Singapore. Their Bird Group Records Committee has taken on the role of record keeping and since 1984 has been publishing a consolidated list of all known bird species sighted in Singapore. Using records that go back all the way to the 1950s, collected from eminent local birders then. The Nature Society of Singapore has continually updated their list every year since. It is known as the Singapore Birds Checklist. Government bodies like NParks or the Singapore Botanic Garden that don't have their own records committee rely on the Nature Society's data as the accepted official count for bird species. However, there are a number of independent special interest groups that come up with their own definitive bird checklists. The slight differences in the final count are due to the different parameters that's used by these different groups. For example, to remove a bird from the list, one group may use 30 years as the last sighting, while another may base it on, say, 25 years instead. An example of this is the plain sunbird that has not been seen for a very, very long time. It has been removed as an extirpated bird from some lists, but remains on others. So, just like that, local birders are happy if they already have the other six sunbirds and can claim to have the complete set now. But then, purists might still say, no, 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 there's one more. Haha. One group may include recent sightings, while another needs more time for further evaluation. So, the frequency and timeliness of publishing the checklist may be another factor. In 2021, local birders learned that a new woodpecker and a new kingfisher were added to some lists. That meant their lifers for this genera are now incomplete and are challenged again to get that one more bird. Some may use breeding or nesting as a criterion. If a migratory bird was not seen breeding locally, it might not be included. One case is the milky stork or the mast lapwing, which, although have been seen for years, were never included until recently for this reason. Some lists may even include long-term residents that were previously escapee birds, while some groups will not accept escapee birds or released birds, like the cutthroat finch or the monk parakeet. So, the criteria will vary slightly from group to group, according to the factors they define for inclusion or exclusion. But one thing in common with all these groups is that they all agree on a base guideline for their bird list in accordance with the IOC standard. Not the Olympics, but the International Ornithological Committee. As a bird watcher, you can also start your own count, that is, keeping track of all the birds you have seen and identified. This list can be a record of those you have seen or only those you photographed, or both. You may even include those you have not seen but positively ID'd the call. It can be a big year list. That is all the birds you sighted within the same calendar year. Or one simply of every bird you've seen here and in other countries. Of course, if you are recording for your own pleasure, you are at liberty to record as you like. It's really up to you to determine your own criteria. It's an honor system among birders. But it would be good if you can follow the minimum accepted standard for the birding community. And what are these standards? I will briefly mention 4 points that you should keep in mind. One, it must be a positive ID. The bird must match the correct appearance or bird call, found in the right habitat, and has the behavior particular to that species. A photograph will definitely help to make a positive ID. Just saying, I think it's that bird, is not acceptable. It's just your own opinion.
birds spotted by a companion on the same birding trip but not seen by you does not count. 2. It should be a live wild bird. So that excludes pet birds, cage birds, aviary birds, and even dead birds you find on the ground. But birds seen in an open urban area can be counted. 3. It has been ethically observed. It was not trapped, not caught by mist nets, and it wasn't flushed out, and that you didn't encroach onto restricted areas to observe the bird. If you do that, it should not be counted. The last point, birds of the same species count as one sighting. Even for different moths, bird, male or female of the same species, and even subspecies should be counted as one. Now, if you want to compare your count with other international clubs and organizations, then your criteria have to follow international standards. Refer to some of these bird organizations online and you will be able to see what their required bird count standards are. Some of these organizations would be the Audubon Society, the British Trust for Ornithology, Cornell Lab, or nearer to home, BirdLife Australia, or the Hong Kong Bird Watching Society. Or perhaps you are not too concerned about checklists and you just want to enjoy watching and photographing birds, then it doesn't matter at all whether you wish to record or not. It all depends on your birding objectives. But having a record can be a fun way of knowing what level of bird watching you are at. And it helps to keep track of all the lifers you have. If you are new to this area of recording birds, here's a tip from me. There are already many ready-made templates online. You don't need to reinvent the wheel. I'll leave a link to some of these templates in the video description below. Or you can simply use the online eBird app and it will keep track of the sightings for you while sharing your record with the worldwide birding community at the same time. There is also another birds checklist known as the Rare Birds List. Here's a pop quiz for you. Which of these birds are considered as rare in Singapore? And your answer is? Well, actually, all of them are not considered rare birds. Most of these we seldom see, simply because they are migratory rather than being rare birds. So how do we classify a bird as being a rare bird? The accepted definition in Singapore of a rare bird is one that has been seen less than 10 times in the past 30 years. An example would be the white-bellied woodpecker. Now, That's really rare in Singapore and has been my nemesis bird all these years. In fact, I've yet to see it here myself. Today, with the greater influx and concentration of new birders, the rare bird list is slowly being reduced as more eyes in the field now means more of these rare birds are being spotted, like the great slaty woodpecker, the red knot, and the armored falcon. All these have been seen again in the last 5 years alone, thanks to new birders. And because of this wider birding community spotting more birds, the classification period of a rare bird was recently reduced from the previous 50 years to the current 30 years now. In the official 2021 bird checklist, of the 407 listed, 156 are categorized as rare birds. That is a very big percentage. If you do spot any new species or rare birds, please do submit your sighting officially to the Nature Society Bird Group or the Singapore Bird Project for their review, their evaluation, and perhaps for a reclassification of the bird status. If you are new to my birding channel, don't forget to subscribe and give this video a like. That will help my channel to grow and I can continue to make more videos to share with you. And just for you, if you are a new birder and perhaps didn't understand all the terms I use in this episode, you will be glad to know that in my next episode, I will be explaining all the various terms birders use locally as well as in the other parts of the world. So, get out here, enjoy the fresh air, and until I see you again in my next video, happy birding, stay safe, and bye.